in early March, before our school was temporarily closed due to
the coronavirus,
we're told we were to do a video essay. And when I realized semiotics, the study of signs and symbols and their use or interpretation, could be used as a research topic, I immediately thought of doing my semiotic essay on Pink Floyd's 1982 film version of The Wall as my video essay. The Wall was conceived by bassist Roger Waters during one of Pink Floyd's tours in 1977. He modeled the character Pink after himself and former bandmate Syd Barrett, although the character is heavily based off of Roger's hardships with fame and his father's death in World War II. Pink Floyd's The Wall is about a confined but troubled young rock star's descent into madness in the midst of his physical and social isolation from everyone. This movie is honestly chock full of semiotics and symbolism, from political to this. But I'll more so just touch on the biggest examples of semiotics in this film. First off, the wall itself is a symbolic barrier that our main character Pink, played by Bob Geldof, builds around himself to cope with the copious traumas in his life. We're at the end of the movie, during a song named The Trial, where our character dives deep into his own psyche as everything builds up. He eventually ends up giving up and tearing down his wall, meaning he stops bottling everything up, and we watch as both a metaphorical and physical wall is broken down in front of us. Another good use of symbolism and semiotics in this film is in Goodbye Blue Sky. Goodbye Blue Sky is a song about World War II, in which the lyrics go on to describe the Blitz, a German bombing campaign against the United Kingdom in 1940 and 1941 during the Second World War. We watch as a bird transforms into a Nazi eagle which swoops over the English countryside and grabs a piece out of the ground, leaving a bloody wound before birthing a monster machine that releases warplanes. It's very straightforward in its message, but I would be lying if I said this scene didn't completely haunt me the first time I saw it and left me awake that night. I don't really think we have to discuss the two songs Happiest Days of Our Lives and Another Brick in the Wall Part 2, as I feel everyone and their mother know the meaning of this song, being a protest against rigid schooling in which we see children entering a school and marching in unison through a meat grinder. And they become these clay-faced clones that, not gonna lie, they look like that one scene in The Office, before rioting and burning down the school. There are two other parts to Another Brick in the Wall. The famous part is part two, but part one of Another Brick in the Wall, we see as Pink as a young child begins to build a metaphorical wall around himself following the death of his father during the war. And then in part three, Pink dismisses everyone he has ever known in his life as in a song named Empty Spaces, Pink and his wife suffer severe marital problems due to his emotional wall, which leads to her ending up cheating on him. We're shown two flowers both having intercourse, with the male flower being shaped like a phallus and the female flower looking yonic. I'm doing my best to be mature here. They fight before the female flower ends up consuming and destroying the male flower, showing a grave example of the monstrous feminine. And in two of my favorite songs in the movie and the album, In the Flesh and Waiting for the Worms, after we see Pink come out of a cocoon, he hallucinates that he is a dictator and that his concert is a sort of Nazi rally. We see his followers taking the form of those same clay-faced clones, making a statement about how people in fandoms do their best to try to stick out but end up all just being one sort of hive mind again, like it we see earlier in the school. His followers proceed to attack people and other followers and minorities after these lines.
Are there any queers in the audience tonight? Jewish.
No, it's a coon. then holds a rally in suburban London, indicating that his mind has been completely taken over. The scene includes images of animated marching hammers that goose-step across ruins. We also see other graphic imagery, like someone's head being bashed in and the iconic screaming wall. Pink then stops hallucinating and screams stop, where we see him then eventually break down into his own psyche, and we see the trial scene, where he is confronted by these obscene caricatures of his schoolteacher, wife and mother, which we see earlier in the film. This movie is truly one that anyone can pick apart at and analyze. We're shown themes of politics, sex, the educational system, the monstrous feminine, one's own mind and mental barriers. And I think that's enough for now. Thank you for watching.